Thank you. That second number was Our Love Is Here to Stay, the last composition of George Gershwin. This is a contrast. It's the Nigun by Ernst Bloch from the Baal Shem Suite. Thank you. My colleague has disappeared. I wanted to introduce him. I will introduce him, whether he appears or not. He is Jean-Charles Guiraud. We met for the first time yesterday. That is what is amazing about this event. Mouth organ players from all over the world, piano players, they get together. This should be done as a regular event. I hope that every 4 years this will happen in Trossingen, and the 2 years between. In some other capital like London, Paris, New York, or they're not like Trossingen, but they'll do. Would you believe it if I told you that my first visit to Trossingen was in 1934? I'm the only veteran here. By the way, I must warn you one thing. Don't play tennis with Hans Schmidt. He cheats. You hit a very good shot, and he says, out. It is not out. He cheats. Now that I've introduced my colleague at the piano, I'm going to do a number to show that he is dispensable. Watch. Thank you. Charlie Musselwhite couldn't begin to do that. The next number is pure self-indulgence. In 1987, an event similar to this was held in Jersey. Jimmy Hughes, who is the president of this event, promoted that all by himself. It was a great event. And on it, there was a trio, the Serrano Dalmas family from Alicante in Spain, and Antonio Serrano Dalmas. He was 14 years old. He played like an angel. I hated him. Later, I did a concert in Paris with Lauren Mizell, and this was for UNESCO. And as it was a children's fund, I said, look, why don't we bring Antonio Serrano from Alicante and we can do a duet together, which they did. They brought Antonio, he came with his whole family, and we did this duet. And now, as I say, I want to indulge myself. It'll give me great pleasure to do another duet with Antonio Serrano Dalmas. We're going to play, as we've played before, the Malagueña, and if he steals the number, the way he did in Paris, I will kill you.
I won't do it then.
Be very careful. Remember, I'm old enough to be your agent. He did steal it. I will kill him. I wrote a number once. It was for a program about prisons, and I wrote a theme which I called Screws Blues. The reason I called it that is that prisoners refer to their guards as screws. Guards do not like to be called screws. Nevertheless, they are called that. And that is why I call this composition Screws Blues. Thank you very much. If you ever go to prison, call me. I'll come and serenade you. I want to thank my colleague, in fact, a man who I once judged to be champion mouth organ player of England. He's operating my tapes for me, Mr. Brian Chaplin. And Brian, you're about to work again. When I was about 14 years old, I was on the bill with Ruth Etting. I don't know if you remember Ruth Etting, but she was a great singer. Doris Day made a film of her life story. It was called Love Me or Leave Me. And she was married to an honest-to-God gangster. And James Cagney in the picture played the part of the gangster. but I knew the original, and compared to him, Cagney was a sissy. I was standing in front of the theater, and we called him the Gimp. He drew up in a Packard car, and he said, "Hey, kid, come here." I said, "Yes, sir." He said, "You got the ting with you?" I said, "The what?" He said, "The ting, the doohickey." "The tin sandwich." "Tin sandwich? You know, that's a pretty dramatic name for a mouth organ." I said, "Yes, I had it." He kidnapped me. He took me up to the studio where his wife was making a record, and he made them put me on the record. He said, "Put the kid on the record." And Ruth Edding, his wife, who was singing, said, "Gimp, we can't add another musician. We have an arrangement." He said, "Ruthie, baby, I don't think you hear real good." I says, "Put this kid on the record." Now, in the band, we had Benny Goodman, Jimmy, and Tommy Dorsey, Joe Venuti, Eddie Lang, and they put the kid on the record. And at the end of the session, I said, "Excuse me, sir, how much am I being paid for this?" He says, "You little bastard, get out of here." And you know, I was only 15 years old. I knew that was constructive advice. I left. And when the record came out, my name wasn't on it. The reason I'm bringing all this up is that same week, I wanted to get away from that theater. I went to the Roxy, where Paul Whiteman was playing on the bill with his own film, The King of Jazz. And I hung around the stage door, and whoever came in or out, I'd blow the mouth organ in their face, hoping someone would say, "What a talented kid," and give me a job. And Whiteman's saxophone player, the great Frankie Trumbauer, heard me, liked what he heard, took me into Whiteman's dressing room and says, "Paul, listen to the kid." And I played poet and peasant. And when I finished playing, Whiteman said, "Let me hear you play the Rhapsody in Blue." I was 15, I couldn't handle the Rhapsody in Blue. Technically, it was beyond me. But I couldn't admit that to Whiteman, that there was anything I couldn't play. So I said, "I don't like Rhapsody in Blue." So he turned to a young man I hadn't noticed before, and he said, "How do you like that, George?" That's how I met Gershwin. But about 3 years later, there was a farewell party given for me at the home of a man named Jules Glenzer. He was vice president of Cartier, the jeweler. And suddenly, Jules said, "Larry and George are going to play the Rhapsody in Blue." Well, by then, I'd heard it so many times, it was in my head, I thought I could handle it. George Gershwin sat at the piano, I started to play, and it was one of those evenings when two musicians had rapport. And when we finished playing, Gershwin got up, put his hand on my shoulder, and he said, "The goddamn thing sounds as if I wrote it for you." Which I wouldn't mind as an epitaph, because to me, the goddamn thing still does. Now, I have Gershwin on piano roll, and what I would have liked best was to play that piano roll on a reproducing piano. We couldn't find one, but I do have it on tape, so the first notes you hear will be George Gershwin himself as we recreate the duet that we did together in 1934. Here is George Gershwin and Larry Adler, Rhapsody in Blue.
Thank you.
I was terrified that the applause was going to die down and I wouldn't get to do my encore. I so wanted to do that encore. In fact, if you'd have stopped applauding, I think I'd have done it anyway. I'm dying to do it. It's, again, Brian, I'm so glad you came. You've made my evening. After the show, come to my dressing room, I'll make yours. I need Brian again. I hope he's still there. Are you still there? Yes. We're going to do the Rodrigo Concierto de Aranjuez. This is the middle movement of the guitar concerto. It's been played by Miles Davis on trumpet, James Galway on flute. People have sung it. I think it fits the mouth organ very well. And here is the middle movement by Joaquin Rodrigo Concierto de Aranjuez. Thank you.